coming out tonight. I was very pleased when Sue came months ago, it seems, to talk about her photos. And she had a lot of work to do to get them ready, to get them labeled, and they look beautiful. They are beautiful. I know very little about the trip, but she went in the spring with Salem State University, the Genocide Studies program, and I know it has a longer title than that, but
it does.
but that's close enough. And these are photos that she took when they went over there to study the Bosnian genocide from 20 years ago, and they're amazing. And I'm not going to tell you much more because Sue is going to fill us in on everything. And please join me in welcoming Sue Woodcock. Speak for a little while, and then be happy to take some questions.
Questions, yes. Thank you, Diane, and thank you, everybody, for showing up. This is a good test for me. As Diane mentioned, I went to Bosnia and Croatia in April with Salem State University's Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies.
I knew there was a word on this.
It's basically the North Shore Holocaust Center was kind of absorbed by Salem State, and it's growing, and it's a certificate program now that people can get. In genocide. I'm not an expert on Bosnia, Croatia, or genocide, but I have served as a witness, and that is a big part of genocide studies, is witnessing the before a genocide, the during a genocide, which many of the army troops and refugees experience, and then the afterwards when you go and visit a place like I did 20 years or so after the genocide happened to see what's become of the community now. So. Before I go on, genocide basically just means a group that wants to wipe out another group with race, religion, lifestyle, sexual preference, or ethnicity. In this case in Bosnia, it was Muslims. Winthrop is not, It had genocides here in Winthrop also. It's one of the few communities on the North Shore that have had genocides. They had the Nipmuc Indians in the 1600s that were put out on Deer Island by King Philip. And then during the Great Famine, I guess there was a large chunk of Irish immigrants that were sent also to Deer Island, and many of them died there also. And there's a long debate about the British and genocide and the Irish and all that too, which is a whole other topic. But anyways, this trip to Bosnia, I didn't really know what I was going to be experiencing when I got there. But there's this part of the trip took place in a town called Mostar, which is between Sarajevo and Medjugorje. And while there in Mostar, there's a lot of bombed out buildings, and then there's brand new buildings. The hotel I was in, gorgeous, because it had just been built. But the graffiti that is on the buildings that are bombed out now is interesting to look at. And one of the ones that I looked at in Mostar, at the bottom someone had written, we all live under the same sky. And I'm not one to get really deep or anything, but that one kind of just struck me, that so many different people around the world are living under the same sky, and the genocides are what happened. So, and it was actually a German gentleman that came up with that phrase during the 1940s. There's a lot of rebuilding that's going on. As you'll see in some of the photographs, you'll see some in Sarajevo, bombed out buildings next to one of the more modern bridges that is up today. Sarajevo was known as a sniper city. Basically, anybody that was going to work, going to school, was shot at. They used tanks to help move people across the streets. So your crosswalk would be a tank, starting on one side, shuffle along, the snipers would shoot, and let them off at the other side so people could run away. And that went on for a good 10 years of sniping. Today you can walk around Sarajevo very openly. It's a very nice community. There's a lot of new business that's showing up there, right down to McDonald's and Al Jazeera News Station, big brand new building for them. And again, all these buildings during the war were bombed out and just rebuilt now. The Olympic City was in Sarajevo for the 1984 Olympics. And the sad thing there now is because there were so many people killed during the siege in Sarajevo that the football stadium and the running track around it had become a cemetery. So you go through this beautiful area of a sports complex and then boom, cemetery from the siege. There was also a tunnel that was dug by the airport. You got to go in this tunnel, you can't stand up in it. And they dug this by hand to get all the way through. They've closed off a portion of it now. But the tunnel to the airport was the only way people were getting supplies. They were living without water, they were living without food. And this, once the tunnel was built, things, you know, just got better with supplies and stuff. Forgive my stumbling here, because we're going to switch to one of the most interesting places there in Bosnia is a town called Srebrenica. And in Srebrenica was probably the most famous massacre that occurred during this genocide. There were 8,392 Muslim men and boys rounded up and paraded down streets to their death, basically. And all of this happened while, let me get this straight, there were United Nations troops that were there from, who were Dutch. The Dutch basically turned the town over to the Serbs who were attacking the Bosnians and started this whole siege. Well, today you'll see in this couple of photos, the cemetery is just loaded with these almost, I think they've got 6,000 graves in there now. And only one of them is Christian. There's one pillar grave that's a cross on it instead of the Arabic. So anyways, at Srebrenica, they killed the 8,000 men and boys. The rest were kept in a refugee center, which was across the street. It was an old battery factory. It was like an old building from GE that they used to camp the refugees in. And again, this was run by the Dutch, the United Nations. It definitely wasn't the best of situations to be in over there. Today they're still finding pieces of bodies that were from this massacre. And traditionally in Muslim religion, they want to bury the head of a person. They need at least the head. But now it's become so bad that they're finding fragments and they're not finding complete skulls that they are burying the pieces of bone that they're finding and then labeling the grave and putting them in the Srebrenica cemetery that's there. There's a beautiful cemetery there now. There's an outdoor open mosque that's open for everyone. That's beautiful too. And it's just really moving to walk in there and just like step away from everybody else and realize it's just a sea of people that were all killed. Same reasons, same things. The names of families that go on. There's not just, you know, one Smith that's there. There's 20 Smiths that were shot. So that's kind of interesting there too. This all ended finally with a Dayton agreement. Agreement that was signed in Paris on December 5th, 1995. So basically through the whole 1990s, this area that used to be Yugoslavia just was under siege. It was happening in Croatia, it was happening in Bosnia, and it was the Serbs mostly that were coming through and having, you know, attacking the others. So I think that's about it. Any questions? Sure.
What kind of Muslim population is there now? Are they rebuilding?
Large. It's 60-70% Muslim. And nobody knows who's Muslim over there because nobody covers. The ones you'll see, one conservative Muslim woman who's covered completely, she is the exception. Typically, they would look like you and me, just out regular, no covering. Although you will see some that do cover. For the most part, they don't. You don't know who anybody's religion is by just looking at them. There's like 150 mosques in Sarajevo. So the cool thing is that call to prayer, which they do 5 times a day, you will hear it throughout the city. The imams just chanting whatever they chant, their prayers or their call to prayer. And that's a pretty interesting thing to have happen too.
What religion are the Serbs?
I believe they were Catholic. They're Christian, most definitely Christian. A large Catholic population.
What prompted you to go and pursue this?
A lot of people want to know that.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's just been an interest of mine since the most famous genocide is the Holocaust, the Jewish Holocaust. And most people, when they hear the word genocide, think of that, not realizing that there are genocides all over the world. Vietnam, Northern Ireland, all sorts, you know, Winthrop. It was just something that struck my interest.
You were there for?
10 days we were there.
You must have cried the whole time.
No.
It's...
I'm not like that.
Oh.
I got choked up when I was at the cemetery and I walked away from everybody and I just started looking at the rows after rows after rows and that they all died the same day, that they all died the same week. And they're all male. The town now is loaded with females. The proportions are off because of that. Yep.
Why did the Serbs agree to a peace agreement?
I don't know. I didn't get that far enough in my studies to learn about the peace agreements and what happened. I know NATO was involved, United Nations were involved, there's an American general that was involved, it was Slobodan Milosevic, there was that whole era, so I'm not really sure what prompted them to give up.
I have a feeling you must have taken a lot more photos.
There's 600 photographs.
Right.
So this
Do you
is just,
think you could
this,
maybe pick a few
this
and
is just
share
30.
More
sure.
details about some of them?
Sure.
Show us.
I'd like to tell you when you get right through to. Up here I have an article that I wrote for the Lynn Journal that explains about these two gentlemen. This is Claude and this is Hassan. Hassan is Muslim. He lost his brother, twin brother, and his father during that march that happened through Srebrenica. He was able to run away. He has an incredible story of surviving in the woods, surviving with no food or water, and then finally making it to a town by the name of Tula, where he was able to get help. Anyways, Claude grew up in Rwanda, so he experienced a genocide there in Africa. And then he met Hassan, and I just thought it was like a really touching moment that the two of them met each other. They both experienced genocides. They're both young guys, and it was just, you know, it doesn't happen. But very, very interesting people. This one is in Srebrenica. And again, those are the tombstones. Down here is the mosque. And I learned not to take pictures in a mosque because I thought we were in an open-air mosque. I had my camera out, we were kneeling on rugs, and he started talking, and I had a GoPro camera. So I had the GoPro camera set up, and he said, "This is no photographs." And I said, "Okay, no photographs," but that was my lesson, not to photograph in a mosque, even if it's outdoors. But across in the background of the photograph, you'll see the battery factory. And it was still, they still had a lot of machinery in the factory that was just rusted and toppled over and whatever. So the conditions are really poor. They're turning that into a Holocaust center so that people can come in and look at photographs, bring in school children and teach them. Because there's a generation there now that definitely experienced the war, and now there's a new generation coming along that doesn't know what happened. So.
Mm-hmm. What's the average age of the person living that experienced it?
Well, 20 years. Hassan is 32, and somebody else that I met was 36, so 30-ish, where they might have been a little kid during the time, and then, you know, if they're infant or whatever, they wouldn't, you know, go to a refugee center without you about it. And this is the other one that I liked. It was that we were driving to Srebrenica, and on the bus, I kept looking out the window and seeing these signs hanging on evergreen trees. So finally, I asked, "What's with all the red signs on the evergreens?" And they said, "That's where the bombs are." So, and they had one little boy who had been camping with his family about 2 weeks before we had arrived. The boy was out playing in the woods and did come across a trigger device and was killed. Because of the mines. There's about 200 mines left in the area now, and they basically advise you to stay on trails, stay on roads, not to, to go off, so, because they're still there. So, and then, white people with a cow. I just found this interesting because on this hill 20 years ago were tanks and artillery guns and all that good stuff, and now we have a family that's back with its cow again, living on the side of the hill. This is probably my most favorite thing that I saw while I was there. It doesn't look like much, but then I looked down and I read what the people had written, and it says, a place for a kiss. It's right along the river's edge, and if you look up to the hills, it's actually kind of pretty, I guess, and a nice little spot, but they have these all over town in different places so that you would actually stop and look around or get a kiss, so. That's about it. Call to prayer. He's actually up about 100 feet off the ground, and then the rest of the spire goes off. But again, you'd hear these, during the daytime when you're walking around, you hear the call for prayers. This building here is very typical in Sarajevo, and Mostar also, and right next door you will have an absolutely brand new building. They don't rehab the old building that got bombed out, they just put up a new one next to it. It's a little strange. So, any other questions?
You think because they don't want to be, they want to stay reminded about it?
It's cheaper.
Just cheaper than.
It's cheaper to put up the new one instead of rehabbing the old one. Not like in America where we rehab things and.
You may not have the money to.
Yeah.
To destroy the old one that has all.
I really don't know. They just, I mean, money is an issue. Sarajevo itself doesn't get the money that a place like Croatia got. Croatia got a lot of money for their rebuilding. And it shows there are, in Croatia, which is the man in the red vest, he was playing an instrument as you walked into the walled city of Dubrovnik. Croatia, for some reason, got more money for rebuilding. So their tourism is really up. They have ships that are coming in with tourists on them. They're pretty much running back up at a good speed now. Sarajevo is still trying to get up to speed, but they have some really fantastic restaurants. I went to one restaurant that was Italian made to order, so I said, okay, I'll wait, and while I was waiting, the chef came out and said, I'm trying a new soup, do you want to try it? I came out and sampled some other foods. They had just opened up, and they wanted to get an American's idea of what their place was like for Italian food, and I said, I'm not Italian, but it's pretty good. So Sarajevo is moving along.
Are you going to go back?
Probably not. No. I want to go other places.
Where do you want to go next?
The next trip for the genocide studies is in Rwanda. That's 2 weeks, and it's working in an orphanage village where there are several orphanages make up the town, and working there, and then the following week doing the genocide studies.
How many years has it been since Rwanda? Because I can't believe it's been 20-odd years since Croatia. You remember it on the news.
Rwanda was like going on almost at the same time, yeah. Or similar time. You know, the Lost Boys and all that stuff. That was definitely the 90s. So.
It's still not. It's still kind of.
It's still iffy.
Kind of going on, like,
isn't it? Well, yeah. I think it always, when one weaker group, and there's still the different groups that are over there. Some are weaker than others. My friend Claude, from the trip, he said, you know, growing up there, everything was fine until this political group called the Tutsis came along, and that's when everything started stirring up. Are we good?
Fascinating.
Very good.
Take a look at the pictures. If you have any questions, I'll explain the pictures further in detail if you like. Or
we should say the pictures are going to be in the library for a while.
Yep.
We'll have them set up in the reference room if anybody missed the program tonight and they're watching on cable, they can come by the library and see the photos.
Mm-hmm.
They're mounted beautifully. And
you can pick them up.
And then they call you.
Sturdy.
Right? Yeah. So thank you.
Thank you.
have a cupcake.
Thank you.